John, there'll be people looking at this video right now going,
who is that?
Guy looks vaguely familiar. And of course, lots of people will know you as the host of The Amazing Race Canada. But I would argue, let's fast forward a lot of years into the future, people will remember you for 15 minutes of teaching a nation how to celebrate, or however long that went on
right.
for. Tell me a bit about how that happened. Was that just spontaneous? Was that just you? And for people who wouldn't remember, I mean, even at the medal ceremony, you dusted off the podium, jumped up in this big scream, very un-Canadian, by the way.
Maybe a little bit. It was. I think the only thing that I can account for it is pure unbridled joy, which is happening to an individual who's not thinking very far ahead. And, you know, if I had a thought about anything, it wouldn't have been as authentic. It wouldn't have been yeah. as spontaneous, and it would have been somehow contrived, and I think people would have been able to see through that. You can always see the people that are, the wheels are turning, and they look yeah. like they're worried about making a mistake. I could have cared less. It was
really?
Sort of like
Seriously?
My, the platform that I'd been given, it was like, yeah. how can I do anything wrong here? As long as I don't go off about politics or religion or anything, you know, untasteful, being myself and celebrating Canada can't yeah. be displeasing to anybody. So that's all we were doing. We're having fun, for sure.
And the thing I think was interesting about that whole procedure was that, and I was somewhat tongue-in-cheek when I said that was very un-Canadian of you, but I think because you celebrated the way you did, it connected with Canadians. I think people want to celebrate. Do you think it's important in life?
Oh,
we celebrate.
You have to. Without celebration, there's no vive la joie. There's no reason for pursuing. Because I mean, if you reach a goal and you're like, that one's done, next.
Yeah.
I mean, that's too. Blech. I mean, that's not what we're about. We're about striving for yeah. big goals here in Canada and celebrating them when we get them. Not in a beat your chest bravado. I'm better than everybody else in the world.
Yeah.
But thank you for helping us get here collaboratively. Sort of an attitude. And we don't accomplish anything in our lives by ourselves, or very seldom. The things that are worth accomplishing happen with the teams. They happen with other people's input and guidance and encouragement. That's how things get done, and that's what we were celebrating in Vancouver in 2010.
Gotcha. I want to talk a bit about how you became a champion, all the kind of the pieces of that. And let me start by talking about mom and dad. First of all, were they tall like you?
Well, to say that I'm tall would be a stretch, and to say that they're tall like me would even be a greater stretch, because my papa is 5'6". He's second tallest in our family.
Oh, wow.
And I'm 5'9"-ish,
yeah.
And so I tower above everybody.
Wow. And so tell me about the role they played in you becoming, I mean, are they tough like you? I mean,
yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, and you know, Pop was a hockey player, and he was a small guy, and he played senior hockey at a competitive level as well back in the early 70s. But it wasn't that physical giftedness or anything that I had from my parents that allowed me to be successful. It was attitude. It was a notion that if I wanted something in life, that I needed to invest in myself, that I needed to believe that it was possible, and I needed to have the heart to go for these things in life. And that's the things that my parents imbibed into me, which allowed me to be successful. You know, they're small people, small in stature, but they've worked doggedly their entire lives for the betterment of their community and for the betterment of their family. And those two lessons in life are going to stick with me until the day that I die. And they've allowed me to give back and receive an awful lot with an attitude like that. I've been the beneficiary of my community in Russell, Manitoba. I mean, the Mission Montgomery that they had for me before 2010 was so inspiring to know that I had an entire community of my home, where I still consider home. I mean, I'll be from Russell, Manitoba my entire life. I can call home Victoria now, but I'll always
sure.
be from Russell.
Yeah.
We're behind me 110%. And whether I won, I lost, or I stunk the place out, I knew that core base would be a fan of Jon Montgomery and would have my back, and that's all that mattered. I could go there and lay it all on the line with not having to worry about failing because I knew that they had my back.
But did you worry about failing in the sense to be a champion? I'm assuming every athlete, every person to be successful has to transform something about themselves to get to that level. What did you have to change?
There's a physical element of preparation that went into it, but I'd say attitude was the one thing that I had to transform from my early days in skeleton racing and really struggling and having a bit of a, not a defeatist attitude, but a bit of a feeling sorry for myself attitude was why can't I be as good as some of these other new recruits? Why am I struggling more than some of the other athletes? But through dogged determination, through tenacity, through sticking with it, I was able to realize the rate of development that I could be happy with. I soon surpassed some of those athletes that I was struggling to keep up with in the beginning. And an attitude, I think, was the one thing that I had to develop about myself to allow me to get to that next level. And you can see a lot of people with a lot of talent, but really bad attitudes. And that is stifling. With a bad attitude, regardless of how much, I guess, talent you have, you may be successful at a particular moment in time, but I think in life in general, you'll be held back. You won't realize the types of opportunities that might have been afforded you with a better attitude.
Interesting you say that. It's probably a year or so ago, I was reading an article that identified two things as the main predictors of success. One was grit, and the other was self-control.
Yep.
And when you talk about how self-control, and you mentioned your attitude in particular, paid big dividends for you. So self-control doesn't sound that exciting, but why was it such a big deal?
Because it's something that you're tasked with every second of every day. Showing self-control in situations where it can get the better of you. Your attitude can get you better of you. The intensity, the fire that burns in your belly, which allows you to be competitive, needs to be contained. Because if you just let it go unbridled in life, you're probably going to be an ass. You're probably going to offend people. You're probably going to be off-putting to a large portion of the population. But when you channel that internal fire, when you channel it into something productive like sport, like competitive nature in business, like championing your community, that's when it can pay dividends. That's when it can be inspiring for other people to watch you do your thing. Mm-hmm. And self-control for me was, having the self-control to react positively to negative situations and to be mindful of the fact that simply a setback here isn't going to be the end of the line or isn't going to be all-encompassing. It just needs to be reworked and remanaged. And I've learned that time and time again, that failures are not the end of the line, not by any stretch of the imagination, that they shape who we are, and that the attitude that you choose to come out of some of these failures will ultimately determine how well you can be successful in the future and how you move forward with purpose.
You have been one of the forum speakers for Farm Credit Canada, and I've met a lot of them over the last 10 years, all of them actually. But one thing that's really consistent about all of them, which is kind of unique, is that they're obviously high achieving people, but they think differently when it comes to making mistakes and learning from mistakes. It's a philosophy of networking. Rather than learn from my mistakes and go it alone, it's about networking and failing faster.
Absolutely.
You talk about in Vancouver how you as a team figured the track out together faster. Tell me, and you learned from each other's mistakes, essentially.
We had the capacity to really grow as a team because we were so fractured, I think, coming into Vancouver, that it was a real opportunity for us to come together as a unit and to realize what can be done together. And no more in my skeleton career was it ever apparent than it was in Vancouver Whistler preparation for the 2010 games, where we bought into this philosophy of peer coaching. And whether you were coaching or you were being coached, you were getting better. You were getting better simultaneously with helping someone achieve their potential and achieve their ability to execute this track. By further ingraining those muscle memory patterns, those notions of steering patterns in corners, you're imbibing yourself with positivity, with reinforcement of the steering patterns and so on that would go on along the track. So through the collaborative approach, through synergizing, through trying to dissect this track and as you said, fail faster, we were able to build up faster, learn from those mistakes, not just my own, but also my teammates as well. And it expedited the learning curve tremendously. And I'll take that same approach to every aspect of my life, whether it's in business moving forward. I'm going to try and learn from those who have gone it before me instead of trying to reinvent the wheel. And I think I learned this, you know, the hard way. And I don't talk about it out there. I do in some of my presentations, but about failing to qualify for the 2014 Olympics to defend that Olympic gold medal through an exercise of trying to build my own equipment. And I tried to go it alone in that regard because I didn't have the capacity to work with any other people. So the only way I had to influence the equipment that I was sliding on was through my own involvement. And I needed more people around me to expedite that. I needed to fail faster with other people making mistakes so that I could learn from them instead of it just being me. So we went through six versions of that sled. We spent six figures of our money that didn't even belong to us necessarily.
Wow.
And we put everything on the line for that chance to represent in 2014, and we fell short. It also made me realize that the world still spins. Falling short of a huge goal like representing your country and in a medal that we earned together in 2010 and 2014, was defeating.
Yeah.
But it was just that. It was a moment of sorrow. It didn't leave any deep lacerations.
Okay.
Regrets. Regrets are deep lacerations that don't heal.
Yeah.
Falling short of a goal is simply a bump in the road, and you wake up from that, and you get over it. You don't even think about it as a failure anymore. You look at it as something to remind you that you got to keep going for it. And I'll apply that same throw caution to the wind approach to the rest of the things that I do in my life, knowing that in falling short, world keeps spinning, people keep going, and nobody really counts you out as a loser until you do yourself.
And final question for you, and you have all kinds of abilities you sort of find out here, hither and yon. you worked as an auctioneer.
Yeah.
Every farmer watching this has been to auctions, multiple auctions. What is it about a good chant? Like, are you casting a spell on people?
It's hypnotizing. Honestly, you're being hypnotized with repetition and pitter-patter of a man's tongue against the roof of his mouth. And people are captivated by the auctioneer for whatever reason. I think it's the speed at which things happen. I think it's just that excitement that is building with getting to sold, you know, which everybody's waiting for. How high can we get before, you know, we can sell this thing from the auctioneer's perspective and from the buyer's perspective? How low can I get this thing for? The excitement of a good deal is always tangible at an auction sale.
So what's with your chant? Like, does it have any patterns?
I went to the Worldwide College of Auctioneering, and so they're known for their chant, which is, I'm bid $1, now two, would you bid two? I'm bid $2, now three. And so you start from that.
You're actually saying words?
Yeah. I'm bid $1, now two, would you bid two? Anybody want to bid two? Got a bid two? Anybody want to bid two? Got a bid two to buy?
Wow. Who knew that was actually...
Got a bid two to buy? Want a bid two? Got a bid two? Anybody want a bid? Got to advance a bid?
Wow.
Yeah.
And so there is actually something I did not know.
Real world. Some guys don't have words. I have filler words that are actual real words. Some guys use gibberish, which I don't like as much, but because I like to hear sentences. I like to hear people stringing together thoughts, words, and making fun of people in the audience at auctioneer speed, which usually only a trained ear hears, and the guy who's being made fun of is looking around, you know, looking under the bonnet, wasting people's time.
But you're entertaining people, aren't you?
There's an element of entertainment,
absolutely,
for sure. And running the show and being the sort of the center of attention, which, of course, I'm sure you can tell that I hate, and it's something that I've totally not been attracted to my entire life.
You're not a natural at it at all. Hey, thanks very much. I appreciate it. It's been a lot of fun.
Pleasure.